Greetings and welcome back to another live stream over here on Switched to Linux. Let me unmute everybody before I forget. And we are joined once again with Dan and Salbu. Dan, how's it going today?
Cold, rainy, no sun.
Are you going to get that stream of snow that's coming along, or is that going to pass you by? Not sure.
I don't know. It looks like I'm going to get more rain than snow.
All right. There you go. Salvo, are you getting more rain than snow?
Yeah. My lawn is starting to show up. So.
Okay.
So everything is melting.
All right. So it's all melting. There you go. Well, today we're talking about, is Linux hard? The reason I wanted to talk about this one is I was actually on a live stream yesterday with the guy. There's actually a guy who streams, I don't think out of, but I think near Slab City. And on my travel channel, on Tux Traveler, I released a video on Slab City this week, which became a little popular. And so the guy from Slab City emailed me and said, hey, you want to be on the show? And so I said, sure, why not? Well, it, you know, as we were discussing things, it came out that I do things with privacy and Linux and things like that. And there was a guy in the comments, and I don't know if he's going to show up here or not. Probably not. But if he does, you know, he was in the comments going, Linux is hard and open source software just doesn't work and all these types of things. And I'm like, no, that's really not really the case in my experience. So we're going to talk about that. Of course, the funniest part is when he decides that he wants to have a phallic swinging competition, be like, well, I was taught how to build computers with Windows 98 with a guy who has a computer science degree. Like, so? Let me be clear. A college degree in computer science means your degree is 5 years old and you're not really up to date. unless you guys went to a really good school, like, things like that. But I'm like, you know, I was like, Windows 98, that's when you started? Come on, my friend. I was programming basic
hardware
on 3.1, you know. But we're going to talk today about this. We're going to talk about, is Linux hard? And sometimes it can be, sometimes it doesn't have to be. But we need to get over this barrier of thinking Linux is about being geeky in a terminal and things like that. So we're just going to have a kind of a casual conversation. I'll go ahead and I'll remind you again tomorrow as well. I'm going to take a couple days off of Switch to Linux content just because I am so far behind in web design work right now, and I need to get that queue cleared. So what that's going to mean is I'm not going to do a separate video on Saturday. I'm not going to do a video on Monday for sure. Tuesday, I rarely do a video anyway, and I will be back on Wednesday next week with a video. So it's going to have a couple
days. You're
going to
do one tomorrow night though, right?
Yeah. Tomorrow, weekly news roundup is on. So weekly news roundup is good. So that means we're going to do the weekly news roundup live. We're going to release the privacy portion like we always do. And the business portion is going to go live on Sunday like it usually does. I'm just not putting the extra time into a Saturday video or a Monday video so I can get caught up on all of my work, because I have a boatload of work to finish up on.
Good, I can take a nap on Saturday.
Yeah, there you go. You can take a nap. So that's the thing. So anyway, and I'll try to remember to remind you guys tomorrow about that as well. So I'm getting back into the Pennsylvania-ish area right now. And I'm also, a lot of people are like, hey, you need to come and hang out for a while. So doing some of that as well. Facial says, look how Tom's flexing the beard. Yeah. Wide and long indeed. Yeah. There's only like 3 months of growth, man. Man, if I grow this thing out a whole year, I'm going to look like Santa Claus at the end of the year. Ho, 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 ho. See, give me a bunch of Twinkies and I'll dress as the jolly old man.
There is a guy in Norway who shave once a year after Christmas, mm-hmm. and then his beard is white, so he really grows a white beard, and he let it grow throughout the year. So when Christmas comes around, then he is doing being Santa at a few houses.
Oh, cool. Yes, and let the kids swing off it.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's real. This is the real Santa. All right. Let's check in on the comments, and then we'll get into our basic discussions. I didn't have any specific agenda otherwise today. Silliest news flash ever. Biden selection stalls the Senate nomination hearing because she cannot determine if she herself was black and or female. In what context? Yeah, I was actually considering doing a video on the Christian channel called The Definition of a Woman, The Perspectives of an Actual Biologist, because that's literally what this woman said. Somebody asked her, what is a woman? Well, I don't know. I'm not a biologist. I don't think that this woman is qualified to hand you French fries at McDonald's, let alone sit on the Supreme Court. On that basis, do you really need to be a biologist to define what a woman is? You know, I mean, you may not get the exact precise genetic definition, but you can probably get pretty close based on basic conscious life experience.
It's as easy as just looking at the person, and you can usually instantly tell if it's a man or a woman.
Generally speaking, unless it's like the bearded lady.
She could even come out with, it's the opposite of a man.
Yeah, and that raised a few questions. But anyway, I thought about doing that. What we are actually going to do tonight is I do have John MacArthur's new Legacy Standard Bible here, and we're actually going to be doing a review of that. So if you're curious about that particular Bible translation, we're going to be talking about that on the Christian channel tonight. I'll alert you guys about that near the end of the show as well. Some of you guys may not know I have a Christian channel and a travel channel as well. So. Anyway, back to comments. Faisal, been a few days, weeks to leave my channel, but now Google allowed me to create again. All right. So use Endeavor, migrated to Windows 10 installation to 11. You know what's the worst thing about Windows 11? You can't right-click on the taskbar anymore and pull up the system monitor. Like, first thing I do, I'm looking at a computer at a store. Right-click, let's see the system monitor. That's going to tell me everything I need to know about that computer. Can't do that anymore. Like, what?
I don't want you to know what's in the box.
Yeah. When Microsoft will start Windows 10 sabotage and throttling, or is it already started? I don't know. Any of you guys have any thoughts about that? When is Microsoft going to start throttling Windows 10 to force you to Windows 11?
Oh, that's going to be fine with the regulators around the world.
Yeah. I mean, right now, as we'll see in the weekly news roundup tomorrow, they are going ahead and putting the watermark on all of your Windows 11 devices if they're not supported hardware. So anyway. But yeah, you can assume they will start sabotaging it for sure. Just a matter of when.
Yeah, but they need to be careful because Apple did this with one of their iPhone models. I really do believe they had good intentions of it, but when they throttled old models when the battery was in a certain degraded condition, then they degraded the performance in order to extend the battery life, and people were not happy. Mm-hmm. So there is actually some precedent of no, you can't do this. And if Microsoft need to pay attention to those,
Are you talking about battery gate with the iPhone 6s?
I have no idea.
Yeah, pretty much. And another factor with that, though, are we still there, Dan?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, your screen went blank for me. Another factor with that. Is, as I talked about earlier this week on Monday, think about all of the phones that are now completely obsolete because these guys are turning down perfectly fine towers and bands because they want to prioritize 5G. That's kind of the same thing. It's going to cause a lot of financial waste and things like that. But don't worry, the government will send us more money for that gas.
It's actually making me second think whether I really need a mobile phone or should I just get another landline phone and be done.
Yeah, you know, and if you don't go anywhere a whole lot, yeah, why not, you know? I mean, if you do go somewhere and you get into a problem, nearly everybody else will have a phone. Just make sure you have a little address book with you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, except in my country, they are shutting down the landlines in 3 years' time, I think.
Well, that's fun.
And then the cited reason is that there have been some checks, and this is correct. Almost no one uses landlines anymore. So they they have a few years ago, there was a news story about this, and they visited one of the phone exchanges that could support it supported a big city, and it had only two live connections still. So last year or the year before, they said that I think it's 2 years ago, they said that as of May 2nd of 2020, I think it was, if the phone line is broken in a way that it's could be hard to fix, they are not fixing it. And one of the cited reason was that if a tree blew down and fell down and ripped the cord off, then bye-bye, we are not fixing your phone.
Mm-hmm.
And they are starting to do this. So they are shutting it down in 3 years.
They also pipe the internet through the phone lines here too.
Yeah, there is still a lot of people that can't get cable internet, can't get satellite internet.
I'm one of those
so,
that uses DSL through the phone lines. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we have more motivation here to keep it up.
And the reason that they are waiting until 2025 in order to shut down the phone line was the initial plan was to shut it down last year in 2021, but the Norwegian phone regulatory said that no, you need to. You need to have a plan for, you need to support the infrastructure because you have customers who resell the phone lines. So you need to wait.
What about the businesses that have multi-line phones?
Yeah, I think that Salbu's country is in a lot different place than the United States. United States is still so dependent on those copper phone lines that I don't think that we're going to see them go
really
away anytime soon.
I mean, going to any place and walk up to a counter and they got a landline phone
correct
at the counter.
Yeah.
And in Norway, they are actually discussing how to get fiber into every home within 2026.
Yeah, we do an opposite trick with that too here. We also pipe internet telephone through the
cable
lines.
A lot of the phones we see are still VoIP. All right, in the comments, there is a little bit of discussion by Alf. Just so you guys know, Alf is banned from this channel. He is not allowed around here. We have too many cats over here, and I don't need my cats eaten by Alf. So get this Elf conversation out of here. There's no more Elf around here. He's banned. Elf is banned from the show. I've been getting a Tears for Fears song stuck in my head over heels. I like Tears for Fears.
Yes, I know that one. I have a copy of it.
Which song is that one? What album is that on?
I can't remember what album it's on, but
Over Heels. I have
Head
a lot
Over Heels is one of their popular songs from Tears from Fears.
Yeah, I have to hear it, I guess. I probably have it. I just can't remember it. We're still having discussion about Elf. Dude, Elf is banned. No, he's not allowed around here. He eats kitties. No. Greetings, Moonbase Alpha Grays. How's it going there? Open source Linux driver, so I'm good. Yep. 5-6 chickens born in a day. Now waiting to see what happens to the other eggs. Ooh, there you go. Omelets. That's what'll happen. Let's see. Smash that thumbs up. Absolutely. Also found an interesting PDF, which was a collection of articles from magazines that explain sound synthesis. Getting cooler down here in the southeast. No rain or snow. Yep. A man's growing a Unix beard. That's right. That's right, pretty soon I'm going to start chewing on my toenails. hello there, Enerita. Just closed the daycare. Now sitting your hiney there for a little break. And Tom's on. Yay! The bearded lady's on. Get it right. let's see. I now identify as a lady. I use she, her pronouns. I don't know. Let's see. Look how Tom's flexing the beard. Yep. Linux is going to compare yay versus apt versus yum soon. Yummy. Linux is not that hard, but then again, it depends if you're those nerds who like to compile and build their own distros. Yeah, and the more you're interested in compiling your own distro, the harder it's going to be, but, you know, whatever else. It's always interesting checking out the Christian channel, even if I'm not religious. There you go. Yeah, well, today you'll learn a little bit more about some Bible translations and what makes some of them good and bad if you watch the show tonight. Believer, don't go to church like I should. All right. Had a laptop since 2018. Moved to Linux last year when it wouldn't work well enough with Windows 10. There you go.
Head Over Heels is on an album called Shout, the very best of Tears for Fears.
Is that the only album it's on?
It's probably on another one too, a much older one, but this is a best of album that I could only find the metadata for.
Okay. Yeah.
You want to hear it? You probably get copyright strike.
Yeah, save it for when we end the stream and have our time in between.
Okay.
Government does not send you money unless they want something in return down the road. That's right. Beyond right, forgot again and again and again and again. All right, that must be our FBI agent. That's actually Mark. We have an FBI agent over here. He's listening to us. His camera's off. His microphone's off. It's just an FBI agent.
There's a comment. One of the comments. I'm not sure if you mentioned it, but you have passed it. There was someone stating that AMD GPUs and CPUs are more supported on Linux, and that is unlike Nvidia. AMD provides free software drivers. So.
Yep.
Oh, we have Steve's very own in the chat. Hi, Steve.
Hey, Steve. How's it going there? Oh, kissing Anna Rita. All right.
Yeah.
How's it going, Steve?
Yeah.
NVIDIA GTX 1070 arrived today. Installing the driver on Manjaro was faster and easier than on Windows. There you go. Dan, the Linux man. All right. Alf, we're looking at who exactly was Alf in your van. No, Alf's not allowed in my van. He's banned. Alf is banned. He eats kitties. He's banned. I don't want my kitties to be eaten.
It's open season on Alf.
They're both hiding up front. They're like, you guys keep talking about Alf. We're getting out of here. All right. We have gotten to the bottom of the comments. It's only 18 minutes in. Wow, that was way too long. Should we record this and re-release it? Nah, never mind. I'll just put a link down there at the bottom. All right, is Linux hard? Dan, give us your thoughts. Is Linux hard?
It's as hard as a hard-boiled egg.
All right. Is that hard or not?
No, actually, Linux is not hard. And a lot of it depends on the distro you settle on.
Mm-hmm.
If whatever clicks with you, you may have to do some distro hopping and find something that clicks with you. If you're a Windows user, maybe you'll lean towards Mint, perhaps Peppermint's getting pretty good these days.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'd steer away from Peppermint right now. Peppermint.
Why?
Just
because, oh, come on.
No, because Peppermint just released the new version based on Debian, and it is absolutely not user friendly. It's a good distro. It's just not for beginners anymore. It was for beginners. It is no longer for beginners.
Okay, maybe it's just that I'm used to playing with it. Because
you're helping with them on the QA, so for sure. But no, it's gone backwards in user friendly.
Ubuntu, I would try Ubuntu Mate over the regular Ubuntu, unless you're used to tablet like things.
Or Budgie. Ubuntu Budgie is really good too.
Budgie's good. Zorin is probably good. Mm-hmm. Those would be your easier picks.
Now, before we dive too far deep in this, and I forget, I'd like to mention this too. The most difficult thing for somebody who's accustomed to Windows or Mac to switch to Linux, that one barrier in chemistry, we might call it I'm forgetting my chemistry terms all of a sudden. I had it in my tip of my head right a moment ago. The point you have to go over in your reaction, right? Your limiting reagent there is going to be transferring the operating system to your disk for the very first time. Installing it the first time is going to be hard. It's going to be a different experience than you're used to using your computer.
It can't be any worse than Windows. I got this new laptop here. Mm-hmm. I bought it from Laptop Liquidators, and it come with a freshly installed disk of Windows that's never been turned on before.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing, I open the hood. This thing wants to get into every personality trait of me. It wants to, right off the bat, it wants me to put in my name. Then it wants me to put in my email address. Then it wants my phone number, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but when you are opening the lid, it's already been installed. So most people don't install Windows.
And that is the point I'm making. Actually installing the operating system to your disk is intimidating for somebody. It's not hard. It's extraordinarily easy to do. It's just intimidating for most users the first time because they just don't know what to expect. And that's why so many people use Linux use Windows or use Mac, because you buy the computer at the store, you open it up, and then you just set it up. You don't have to install it.
It's already in there. But still, the Ubiquiti and the Calamari's installers are still pretty user-friendly.
They are.
Install Windows, you can definitely use them installers to install a distro.
Yeah, and to be clear, if you have to install Windows, not just open the lid and set it up, installing Windows is infinitely harder than Linux, just to be clear. But it's just because it's different. It's not hard. It's just different. You're not used to opening up your computer and hitting a sequence of buttons before the computer boots on, and then seeing a screen that doesn't look like a user-friendly, cool GUI, and telling it where to boot and overwriting your hard drive. That stuff, it's not hard. It's just intimidating because you don't know what to expect the first time. So we understand somebody who says, yeah, it's a little bit difficult. But once you get past that first step, it is so easy to install. Mark, are you there yet? You're kind of there, but you're muted everywhere. So if you can unmute, go ahead and chime in if you want.
I would recommend those that want to try Linux to get a cheap computer or another hard drive. There should be plenty of used ones floating around now since everybody switched to SSDs. Or you could buy a cheap SSD and switch it out and put Linux on it to play with it.
Yeah.
Or put it in a box. They even have these cheap dongle cables now. You just plug them into your laptop.
Type drive and boot it right from the
USB port and play with it.
Yeah, and there are many Linux distributions that will run on super low-end equipment. And so you can pick up something used for like $50 to $100 and install Linux on it until get that first experience. Dan?
I think you still can get live distros that actually works on a 486. There are not many left, but there are a few. So if you have an old computer, then Linux is the way to go.
And Debian is a really good example of that, which is a solid one.
Debian, you can even get on 32-bit if all you can find is a 32-bit machine. But be kind of leery with that, because some of the software I'm finding is like really, really hard to find outside the Debian repos.
Okay. Hold that thought for just a second. Mark, we've not updated the server yet, so you're going to have to use like a Firefox-based browser. If you're using a Chromium-based browser, it may not work right now. Go ahead, Dan. Continue.
But like I was looking for testing purposes, you know, for the distro I'm working with, for 32-bit app images, and I go to the App Image Hub, which they now have some, it's like the Flat Hub or the Snap Store. Now they got an App Image Store. And you take the little box, you check it down to 32-bit. Well, people are dumping their 64-bit app images in the 32-bit slot. I mean, I'm like, cool, they have Strawberry in here. And then I go to look for the app image for Strawberry. And in the download menu, they got not just app images, every kind of deb package, RPM, and everything else in there. So I pick an app image, I click on it, I open it up, and it says that it's like Strawberry x86, you know, AMD. And I'm like, okay, this ain't going to work for what I'm testing it for. So
yeah,
Snap Store is really thin. And I found out also that they really don't have a 32-bit toolkit for app images. The people that make them kind of wing it and put them together, other than using a standardized 64-bit toolkit.
Yeah, I think that is intentional, if I remember correctly. Ubuntu pretty much just doing away with 32-bit altogether.
Yeah, and so finding a 32-bit snap is like, you know, they don't.
Yeah, yeah. Good luck. You may as well look for a unicorn out there somewhere.
You know actually, they do exist. I did find some, but they're buried.
Yeah, let's. So staying on the topic, let's talk about snaps, app images, flat packs. Sometimes these might be making things a little bit more difficult to use, not easier to use, because it's fragmenting as if Linux weren't fragmented enough. Now we have fragmentation in software distribution as well.
Right.
So now, is that hard necessarily? I don't think so. It's just, again, it's different.
My rule of thumb is for snaps, unless I really need something special that only comes in a snap package, leave the snaps to Ubuntu distros only. You know, use the snaps with Ubuntu. That's what they're made for. It's a canonical product. Outside of that, app images are nice, but, you know, there's some unknowns about them. And the same thing with flat packs. Being a Debian user, sometimes I actually have to go fetch a flat pack to get what I want.
Yeah. And Arita says, Linux is so hard. My 78-year-old father uses Linux Mint and loves it.
Mm-hmm.
Very true.
Yeah,
very true.
That just proves it's hard.
Yeah. I mean, I have confidence if, like, my mother just, her computer just sucks, whatever else. If I took my mother's computer, wiped it out, put something on it like Linux Mint XFCE, and just set it all up the same way, she wouldn't know the difference between Windows and Linux, and I bet it would work perfectly fine for a long time. I should try it sometime, because I was literally over there today, and she says, I just need to keep that computer there so I can have the internet. I'm like, you do realize you can have the internet without that computer, right? That's the level of intense, you know, computer use, right, for my mother's. I should do that sometime. I should go by, pick up your computer, take it, and say, I'm going to fix your computer, rebuild it for you, and see if you can get it to work and use it. And that would be a hilarious test. If my mother, who is the most computer incompetent person I've ever met in my life, can use Linux, Linux can be used by anybody.
A friend of mine did some 15 or so years ago. He installed Linux on one of his systems that was he shared with his family, and he changed the login screen into there was a skin that you could install which made the login screen identical to the Windows XP login screen.
Oh, nice. Mark, are you there yet? Check. I have a question that Mark might be able to answer better than any of us. DeUltima says that Windows 11 installer is much better. No comment.
Yeah,
I haven't tried
Windows 11. He needs to try a Chromium base there, because I'm using Chromium.
And, oh, you're on Chromium base and it's working for you. Okay.
Yeah, right. But the Firefox is not working for me.
Oh, Firefox is not for you. Okay.
Yeah, then we have a problem that was fixed in the new Jitsi server. Is the making Firefox work, and they decided to just use what Firefox is using because that was supposed to be the standard anyway.
Okay, well, yeah, but we'll get that. I've been saying for what? How long have I been saying? For like 6 weeks? We need to get the server updated. My time is limited, folks. It doesn't help that I have like 30 production websites on the same server. So if something goes crashing down, it's more than the Jitsi server that goes down. That's kind of why I have to have specific time to do it, make sure I have specific backups, roll out the updates. Then we should have something that works a little bit better.
I would also say that about 50% of the people use their computers strictly for web browsing, maybe some email and multimedia stuff. And Linux does that really well. I mean, you can watch your Netflix and stuff like that on Linux as long as you pick a browser that has DRM enabled in it. Mm-hmm. And that's where it gets really tricky, because Chromium does not, but Chrome does. And you can install Chrome on Linux. I had to do it to answer a question on a forum.
Oh, we have sound from Mark.
Yeah, we do. Mark, we got sound from you.
It looks like it's working. I wanted to stay quiet and let Dan finish and surprise you. Oh, my goodness. All I had to do is run just Firefox native, because it doesn't work in LibreWolf. It doesn't work in Vivaldi. It doesn't. working anything else really? That halfway works in Maxthon.
Oh yeah. Mark, have you had to install Windows 11 yet?
No, I'm not on Windows. I'm on.
I've installed.
No, no. Have you installed? Because I know you work with people that still use Windows. Have you had to?
As client machines, not yet, but I've got a customer. I'm holding off until it's a little more mature.
I actually installed it in a virtual machine.
Close.
Dan, how was
actually what I did is I did an upgrade. I actually took my Windows 10 virtual machine and exported it as an appliance.
Oh, okay.
Then I imported it again as an appliance, and then I had like two copies of Windows 10, so I just took one of them and used. And there's a tool for this too, that will help you install it. And get around all the screwball junk Microsoft wants you to have in your computer.
Yeah.
Anyways, the installation was not that bad. It asked you a few questions. Because it was Windows 10 Pro, it went to Windows 11 Pro. And believe it or not, the same key that activated Windows 10 activated Windows 11.
But Mark, what are you missing to use your Raspberry Pi? You're muted, by the way.
But,
oh, well. Mark, whenever you get unmuted, well, what are you missing for your Raspberry Pi? Let's see.
Mark is in. Okay, there's a tool called Windows 11 Updater. I think I found it at GitHub. If you have a Windows 11 ISO, you can use your own. If you're more trusting of the ISO that they will supply you, they will download an ISO for you with the software.
There's a lot of different tools that you can tell it what to download and get installed. Any Linux distributions install that way, because we want to stay on topic as much as we can. Is Linux easy to install? What Linux distributions have the ability to just simply download an installer to install it? Any of them?
I would say, honestly, and I know a lot of people might balk at this, but if they haven't used it in at least a version 34 or later, especially 35, I find that, hang on, let me sit in front of the mic. I find that Fedora 35 is outstanding. I'm currently running GNOME.
What I'm asking, though, right now, though, Mark, is are there any Linux distributions we know of that you can go to their site and you can download an installer where you go to the site, you plug in your USB drive, and through the site, you can get an installable drive. I know Tails does that.
You mean a net installer?
Not a net installer. Because
or
a net
complete
installer,
ISO.
No. Tails has a tool. You can go to their website. You can plug your USB drive into it. And with their website, they will download the ISO, verify it, and write it to your disk in one step. So you don't have to mess with anything. You plug your disk in, run through the steps, pull it out, and you're ready to boot.
I did not know that existed. Yeah. But
Tails does it. LibreElec has a tool to do that, which is cross-platform Windows, Mac, or Linux. I've heard there is at least one other distro that does that as well. Anybody know other ones?
Tool to do that, but it not directly just by going to the website.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of tools that can do that, but that's not exactly what you're asking.
Yeah, my picture that is like you would go to Mint, go to their website, click on download, process where you put it on the stick yourself.
Correct. Yeah. Because that's the big hang-up for most people. Now, I know Rufus could, and I think Etcher maybe could. You can tell
those write ISOs.
So you can plug your drive in. Hold on, Mark. You can plug the drive in, download the software, select the ISO you want. The software will download it, verify it, and write it to the disk. Something like that for multiple drives, because I know the one, I think it was Rufus did that, but all of the versions were completely out of date.
Etchers won't do it for Windows, but Rufus will.
Rufus will. Okay. So that would be a good way to get started.
As far as Linux goes, that is true for Rufus. And also in Rufus, if you follow a specific process that's kind of tucked away and hidden, you're not, it's, they don't make it that aware, but it's a step further. It will let you download any ISO that you want. And that's how you would normally do that to get the ISOs that you want. You can go back, like if you want to, I don't know why you would want to do that unless it's like really older hardware. I did have a situation where I grabbed an older ISO of Windows 10 and then worked my way up from there gradually. And I can't remember exactly why I did that. But there was a reason that I did it that way, because I wanted to, I think I wanted to see stability of the drivers and everything and see how it would do and to know if it was going to be smooth or not.
Yeah.
And I decided that was dumb. Just get the latest ISO from Microsoft.com, download it, keep it on my storage, and then just pull it from there when I need it and put it on the USB and install it.
Yeah, but yeah, that's the way to do it.
Yeah, but Rufus will let you download directly from like one of their mirror sites or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you can also go to Windows.com to do it manually. Microsoft. Yeah,
last I knew it was the packages were a little out of date, but maybe that's fixed. I don't know. Obviously, yeah, I don't use Rufus much.
A lot of them were. Latest I check, I think they did have the 2.1H2 that they, or 2.1H1 at least, if not 2.1H2.
Yeah.
Now, as far as Linux, Tails is the only one that I've ever heard of doing that. I do get your point now. You want to make it for somebody that's not technically savvy, like my client base is that type of person that would need that seamless. It would be ideal if more distros offered that feature.
Yeah, I heard maybe Fedora might offer that, I think. I can't remember. Somebody told me one other popular distro does offer a tool like that. I just can't remember which distro it is.
Well, I run Fedora, and it does have Fedora Image Writer. But like I say, that is a, it's still somewhat manual. Not really, because so long as you have the tool, it'll download it automatically from the website. So that
one of the best ways done previously was when Ubuntu first started. They had an offer where they could ship in the mail a free CD or a DVD that you could boot off from. They had that for many years.
All right. So here.
The tool to download, but at least, you know, if it's a distro specific tool and they put it on the front page downloads, how can you miss that?
Right here on Fedora, just hit the download button. And if you're on Windows or Mac, you can just go ahead and hit the button here and you will just download the application. And this is going to download the application, and that will go ahead and create for you a drive. If you're on Linux, you just have the option for the ISOs. Hopefully you can figure out how to do that. Of course, what's the implication? Hey, you guys on Linux, you guys know what you're doing. Windows and Mac guys, let's hold your hand through this. Okay.
So. That reminds me, a few weeks ago, I was involved in handing a computer to my parents have friends from Ukraine staying with them. And they had to leave most of their belongings behind, but they were are from the western part of Ukraine that has so far not had any have not been directly affected by the war, but they were they decided to move, and they needed a laptop to use, so one of the person from the church donated one, and the old man handed it to me in order for me to install a Russian language operating system on it. And he initially wanted Windows on it, and I actually tried. I downloaded the Russian ISO from Microsoft, and it's not bootable.
One of the problems with the image from Microsoft is it's greater than 4 gigabytes. And so FAT32 can only fit a file that's 4 gigabytes in size. And so when you try and transfer the Windows ISO that you download, it it's not able to hold it, but you can't boot it off of NTFS. It has to be on FAT. So it literally, Microsoft is like, hey, let's ship a ISO that's too large for the format it has to fit on. Only Microsoft would do something like that.
I keep forgetting that there's that limit there.
Yeah, I know, right? And I don't, because somebody had mentioned here in the comments, who mentioned that? Somebody in the comments said, don't forget Ventoy. Peter, thank you. Well, I have a Ventoy bill. I'm like, hey, let's just go throw the Windows ISO there, because I was going to be installing Windows onto a computer for a friend of mine. And so I threw it over there, and it's like, it's not booting. Why is it not booting? Oh, yeah, that's why.
Yeah, so I ended up installing ended up installing Linux Mint on it in an OEM mode. So when I handed it over, they just had to, what Dan said earlier, they just opened the lid, turned it on, and they were greeted with the select language and insert username and password and so on. And then I have installed what they would most likely need. Such as Zoom and a few communication applications.
Okay.
We're going to talk about Ventoy for a minute, because this is another thing that makes Linux really easy to use. Mm-hmm. Now, the setup of Ventoy is not the easiest, and the documentation is not the best. But if you can follow through it and get your drive, you can do it on Windows, you can do it on Mac. I think you can do it on Mac. You can do it on Windows and Linux at least.
You can get download Ventoy, the executable.
You get Ventoy, you put it on the drive, and then your drive just becomes a file repository. You download the ISO, you simply throw it in the file repository, boot off of the Ventoy drive, and it's going to give you a list of all of the operating systems you have. You just select the one you would like to boot.
It's a telephone app. Any bootable ISO.
Yeah.
And it, you know, like Hiron's boot PE, I've got a copy of that on there for when I do diagnostics here and there. Anymore nowadays, I'm having to do a lot less stuff manually, which is fantastic, because a lot of things, you know, once I do the initial install with Ventoy for the purposes of this conversation.
Yeah.
It's an old-fashioned telephone switcher lady. I want this one. Well, let me plug you in.
Our Pi Imager will soon have the download to USB option. I thought Raspberry Pi might. I know they have a tool you can download already. So Raspberry Pi is a good option. Now, I will say, somebody had mentioned up above, you know, Raspberry Pi is a good first Linux experience. I'm not sure if it is, at least not a good desktop computer system. Although the 64-bit version of Raspberry Pi OS is actually nice and slick. I did a review of that the other day. Raspberry Pis can be a little bit slower and laggier, and so they're not the best overall experience to get started, but they're not bad either.
Yeah, I have heard of Ventoy, but I didn't know what it was. I Googled it just now.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet.
It looks like it is not the same, but the closest thing that I've got to something like this was, I think it's 20 or so years ago. There was a tool that you could install that you could install on a floppy back in the day.
Floppy.
It was a boot manager that where you could select which hard drive to boot from, because I got a computer from someone I know that wanted Linux on it, and it turned out that system was not supported. The Linux bootloader was not supported on that system, so it needed a floppy to boot from. So,
yeah, all right. There's a little bit of Zorin slapping and going on in the comments here.
I had a Wendy's burger earlier, trying to clean off the desk.
There you go. Yeah. So I guess we'll go ahead and wrap this one up here. So in brief summary, is Linux hard? In my opinion, no. The most difficult step is getting it first installed. Not because that's difficult. It's actually very easy. It's just something you're not used to doing. And so that makes it a little bit unusual for it.
Yeah.
Dan, give us your final thoughts here.
Yeah.
It can be as easy as you want or as hard as you want. For me, it was a little difficult in the beginning because I like quit Windows cold turkey.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was not going to advance myself into a Windows 10 full, you know, user environment. I think if you're able to use both Linux and Windows and slowly transfer over to Linux, you know, it'll be really easy for you. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, once you know how to navigate around in the distro that you finally settle on, or you may want to stay on Windows for a while and download a bunch of distros and see which one is your favorite. But mm-hmm. it's definitely not that hard. Once you figure out the installation process for one, it's virtually the same for all of them.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Salbu, final thoughts?
There are some that have a little bit of a different installer, but for the most part, once you go through the installer one or two times with like Ubuntu, like Dan said, it's going to get much more comfortable. And I will say that leads into what I was going to say. I'll keep it brief. Just get your hands dirty. Get mm-hmm. in there, look at things, look at some of the distros we mentioned in chat and on stream here. And just try some installers, try the Fedora thing, some others like Tails, if you want like a security focused distro to check your do your online banking and stuff. It's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I still need to set up my flash drive to do that.
I would not be doing banking with Tails. But Tails is good for security. It's for privacy, better prioritized over security. I would do something else for banking stuff. But yeah, because banks get a little bit grumpy when you start accessing your accounts through them. And once you log in, you are immediately de-anonymized on Tails. So don't do that.
I found with my bank, I have to use the same web browser in the same machine. Or else it won't let me in at all. It wants to send me a voice message with some numbers that I got to plug in the website, you know, and make it comfortable all over again.
Yeah. I hate that. It's
They're very secure with the idea of what you're using.
We're going to jump over to Salbu for final thoughts.
It's not hard. It's not hard these days. It was 30 years ago when. There were no GUI installers. And even Debian has come a long way. 20 years ago, in 2003 or 4, something along those lines, I tried to install Debian and I failed because it asked me 200 questions. And I stopped after 20. People who tell it's hard, they are remembering the old way of doing things where everything was done in a terminal. And the terminal can be scary if you don't know how to use a terminal. But and that's also one thing. People who are saying that the Linux is terrible because when you ask a question, they tell you to do this and that in a terminal. And the reason they do that is because they know it will work, because they don't have to figure out that you are using another distribution that they are running.
Are you on Cinnamon or are you on XFCE or Mate? It makes a difference.
Yeah, and what type of where do you go to? Once you open that screen, you're supposed to open that screen, and there are 30 different ways in order to do that in a GUI. Whereas in a terminal, there are two ways, I think, depending on if there is a Red Hat based distribution or a Debian based.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. All right. So we're going to wrap this video up here. So as my final thoughts, obviously, now I think Linux is a lot easier than many people give it credit for, especially now. It is, Salvi said, a long time ago, yes, Linux was hard. It's not anymore. You barely have to touch the terminal.
It's night and day.
So that's the case. Now, tonight I will be doing at 9 o'clock Eastern, so about an hour from now, I will be over on my Christian channel where we'll be reviewing the Legacy Standard Bible, which is the new translation out of MacArthur's group. I've been reading it here for this year, and it's a really good translation. We're going to be talking a little bit about that and why it is and stuff like that. If you're not interested in the Christian type stuff and you want to see more content, I do have a travel channel as well called Tux Traveler. You can jump on over there and follow along on my crazy journeys as I journey around the country and see different things out there. So you can go ahead and do that. And we will be back tomorrow for the weekly news roundup on this channel, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And just a reminder, Saturday and Monday, I will not have new videos on the Linux channel so I can get caught up on some work. Anyway, with that, guys, thanks for watching, and we will see you next time.
Bye, everyone.